Alright, so I'm Mike Bell, I met some of you. Just a little bit about what I do. I'm a photographer, I've been doing it about 10 years. I'm freelance, I live in Asheville. So, Asheville's kind of a small market, and that means doing a lot of different kinds of, you know, it's harder to find one niche and stick with it in a smaller market. So like if you live in New York, you do a very specific thing. If you live in Asheville or Jackson City, you kind of have to branch out from that a little bit. So I do a lot of editorial work, so like magazines and newspapers, some local publications, some national publications. I work with New York Times regularly, Wall Street Journal pretty regularly, and then some of the magazines like Wired and Fortune Magazine and things like that is kind of whatever they come up. For commercial work, a lot of local businesses like Mission Hospital or Grove Park Inn, things like that, law firms, Tupelo Honey, you know, some restaurants, some bigger clients like Stetson Hat Company, have been doing stuff for them all summer, Intel processors, I shot and did that for them, stuff like that. So, but specifically I want to talk about portraits, and more specifically, I want to talk about how to approach portraiture in a less technical way, more about setting and more about interacting with the subject. Because I mostly light my portraits, but I'm showing mostly non-lit stuff to give an idea for how to go about this without making it a whole production. The slideshow is going to be pretty loosely tied in with what I'm talking about, so maybe kind of tangents back and forth talking about the picture and talking about what's on here. The irony is that one of my main points here is planning is very important. My talk is not the most good enough thing, but what's really awesome as a journalist about portraits is that you get to basically break all of the journalism rules, or a lot of them, when you're shooting a portrait. You are in control. When you're normally shooting on a journalistic assignment, you know, as you guys hopefully know, you aren't really allowed to control what's happening in any way. You kind of have to be a fly on the wall, and sometimes you're really like, oh, I wish that person was standing close to that light source, but you cannot tell that person to do that. That's just not part of the journalistic process. That all goes away for portraits. That's an understanding that you're allowed to, when it's understood that it's a portrait, it says in the caption it's a portrait, it's obvious that it's a portrait, you're allowed to basically do whatever you want. So you can position the person wherever you want, you can direct them however you want, you can move things around a little bit, which you never do normally. So I'm going to kind of try to teach you how to make the best use of that power. So, what makes a successful portrait? It pretty well breaks down into a few things. Planning. You don't always get to plan, but if you do, then that's a huge advantage. So, if you can scout a location before you do the shoot, that's huge. Because as much as you want to plan in your head what you're going to do, you aren't really going to know until you get there. Once you see the scene, then you kind of know what your options are, and that's when you really start planning. So if you can do that beforehand and get the gears turning, you can actually go in with somewhat of a plan rather than just planning. Oftentimes that's not going to be the case, especially on journalistic type assignments. You're just going to have to go and do the best you can with what you have. In that situation, I strongly advise telling the person, give me 15 or 20 minutes on my own to figure out what I want to do. So that takes the pressure off. And instead of you're already interacting and like trying to figure it out while you're talking to the person, take that pressure away, say, just make yourself comfortable, relax, I'm just going to get on my own for 15 minutes and figure out what I want to do. Because it's really important not to have that time pressure, which I think is a common thing, especially when you're getting started, because you're feeling like, oh God, I'm taking this person's time, I need to, you know, make this move fast, but you need to be able to, you know, you can't think clearly unless you're fully relaxed and making good decisions. Good light is like half of the equation. I mean, light is everything. As a photographer, if you don't know how to see light, then you're not going to get very far. I'll talk a lot more about light as we go on. Good location. Sometimes the location is somewhat fixed. You're going to a person's house, but within that house, there's plenty of different ways you can shoot at different angles, different places. So, and also sometimes you have some, you can decide the location. You can tell someone to meet you somewhere if you want to, you know, you have a certain spot in mind that's good. So you need to know what a good location is. And good composition. Good composition is way more complicated than just the simple like rule of thirds or where do you put the person in the frame. I'll talk a lot more about composition because you can get really nitpicky about composition. And lastly, getting something from your subject. In realism and storytelling, you really want to want the picture of the person to help tell the story. So it's our job to guide the subject into whatever space, the mental, emotional space is necessary to communicate what we want to. Maybe it's a sad story, maybe it's a happy story. You need to communicate whatever emotion needs to be communicated through the way you interact with the person and the way that you guide them through the photo shoot. So all this like good and bad talk, good light, bad light, good composition, bad composition, what does that really mean? And that it's all completely subjective, right? It's, you know, what's good to me might be bad to you, what's bad to you might be good to me. But there are certain kind of things that are pretty understood amongst people, and this is good, this is bad. But really what it is developing a sensibility. You all now, at whatever point you're at, you have a sensibility, which is basically something that is telling you what looks good or what looks bad to you. As you shoot more and more, you'll develop that, and it'll become a very loud voice in your head. And, you know, for me, it's to the point where it's kind of like it's a physical, visceral reaction. If I see light that I like, it feels really nice. If I see light that I don't like, it literally can make me sick to my stomach. I mean, it's like a very physical thing. Or composition, if you notice when I'm talking to people a lot of times, I might make little adjustments until I'm composing their head where I want them to be. This isn't just when I have a camera. This is all, if you shoot a lot, you'll get to that point where you're always seeing through a lens, not just when you're holding a camera, and you can get very obsessive about light, composition, all these fine-tuned things, where it'll kind of be this really loud voice in your head. Textures, colors, all these things are just kind of like screaming at you all the time. It's not the most pleasant experience, but it results in good pictures. So light, planning for good light. There's certain times of day that are good light, certain times of day that are bad light. We planned this photo shoot to be the very end of the day, which was very nice light, sunset. You need to know how to position the person to be getting that good light. If I was exactly opposite where I am, shooting back this way, then the light would be coming directly at me and that they would have shadow on their face, which, yeah, that's an effect if you want to do that, but, you know, you need to understand what you're going for. And, you know, in this case, you know, I had the light that I wanted the light on her. Window light is kind of like the standard go-to in photography. Windows are just kind of like everywhere and really good for light quality. So, especially, you know, it's important to understand what good and bad quality light means. Light takes on qualities, and there's certain things that are favorable or unfavorable. It's really common to, everyone kind of initially thinks that if it's sunny out, then that's good. That's really not the case. In the middle of the day, I really, at all costs, try to avoid shooting outside in direct sunlight in the middle of the day. The reason is, if there's not clouds, then that's direct light that's not being broken up by anything. So it's going to create very hard light, which means these are the different qualities of light. There's soft light and hard light. This is very soft light. See, it's kind of just gently wrapping around your face because there's no direct sunlight coming in through the window. It's kind of just bouncing around and making its way in through the window. Window light is also good because you know the direction of the light. It's very easy to determine. That's another thing that's very important to determine is the direction of the light and the quality of the light. So a window creates a nice pathway for the light to come through. It's not going to be coming from all over the place, it's going to be coming from right there. And it's a nice soft quality of light. So if you do have to shoot outside, again, you know, you don't always get to make up the rules. You have to kind of make do with the situation. And sometimes you have to shoot, like today we're going to do an example of a photo shoot. And it's the middle of the day, it's probably pretty sunny out. Not a great situation to be on a photo shoot. But we're going to find a spot that's going to work, because we can look for shade, that's one thing, but create nice even light. We don't want that harsh, you know, shadows, especially light from above, crazy shadows in the eyes. You know, we don't want that. So we're going to find a spot that is nice and even lighting, shaded. And we'll talk about some other qualities for a good location. But let's see. So it's really important to understand that light is always coming from somewhere. Even in situations where it's not direct, like direct sunlight is very easy to tell where it's coming from. Window light's very easy to tell where it's coming from. A lot of times, if it's you're in the shade or something like that, it's a lot more tricky to realize where the light's coming from, but it's very important to know. Because still, even now, in this room, the light's kind of all over the place. When I'm looking at you, I'm seeing shadows in your eyes. So I know that the light's mostly coming at you from above. That doesn't mean that it's like that in the whole room. You don't have that. So it's kind of a matter of your relationship to your main light source. And so you need to be able to look at that and see if that's not good, that is good. So, and you can also position people, you know, if their head's tilted back a little bit, they're going to get some of that above light. So you need to know where the light's coming from and what that means for your shoot. If you have a nice window like this, you know, that's why I had her looking out the window, because then it's going to come in right here and just fall off at that, you know, that's a nice spot for the light to start to fall off. If she was looking directly at me, it would be a shadow straight across her face, which is an effect that, you know, that might be good. It's more dramatic, though, and maybe you don't want that. So this next shot, same person, this is Cat Power, introduced really up there. Same exact setting, but totally different lighting, because the light was coming in from over here from that same window, and I used the curtain as my backdrop, and it's a dramatically different effect just by using the direction of the light different. But still, you know, if she would have been looking more toward me, I would have lost the light in her eye, and I wouldn't have had it. So you kind of have to, even in this case, I wasn't really directing her, I was just waiting for the right, you know, her to look the right way, and the right light to hit her right. Yeah, just another example of utilizing window light, understanding where it's come from. It's coming from right here, and so that's, you know, I had her look just where I wanted to, so that it was just going to fall, just, you know, start to fall off right after her eye. This is an example of hard light coming in through a window. It was later in the day, so there's actually direct sunlight coming through the window, which had these, what do you call them, shades, but they were open, so they created this pattern, this line pattern, and hard shadow. So that's the difference between hard light and soft light, is hard light creates these hard line shadows, whereas soft light doesn't. It just kind of comes in a little gently. Let's see. There's some other, these are my lighting shots, just to explain the potential lighting. So this is actually pretty classic lighting for this kind of a shot, a real dramatic type of a portrait where it's light coming in from either side. But I didn't like that. That was just in the back of the helicopter. So the both doors were open, and so the light was coming in from both sides and created a nice, just dramatic, even lighting. And then the backdrop was just kind of the metal backing of the helicopter. So just kind of looking for those kinds of situations. Yeah.
Did the camera you use help it like to be that detailed, or did the light do that?
Yeah, equipment is certainly a part of it. Having a good lens, I mean, that's a good sharp 85mm lens. So that is a big part of it, but it's also not as much of a part of it as I think most people think it is. It's more about knowing how to look at light and predict the way it's going to fall, where the shadows are going to lie. You know, especially if you have something with like an intense ruffled brow, you need to get shadows in there or else you won't even see it. So straight on light wouldn't have worked as well for you. So this is an example of, you know, usually when you have a window, you have it kind of beside the subject. This was a super New York Times recently. This is a bay door, so all the light is coming in directly through that bay door in a factory, and I kind of put him 10 feet back or so from the bay door so that, again, you know the direction of the light is more narrow. More narrow direction of light is good. You don't want it to be coming from everywhere. That way it just kind of comes right in evenly on his face.
What's a bay door?
It's like one of those factory doors that roll up or come down. You know, it's like maybe 15 feet wide, 15 feet tall.
Big trucks.
Yeah. So bay doors are great. You know, a lot of times we'll be shooting in factories and stuff. This is the same effect. This is like a chicken coop. This is for Stetson. But I just put her back into it just a little bit so that I know all that light is coming through that narrower entrance of the chicken coop. And that means it's not going to be coming too much from on top, it's not going to be coming too much from the sides, it's going to fall off nicely on either side. And it's kind of controlling where the light's coming from. Same thing here, there's a roof above him, so it kind of helped bring the light in straight through from straight on. And that's why he doesn't have so much like shadows under his eyes and stuff. And this is also getting to the next topic, which is composition. Once you really understand composition, it will get to the point of kind of obsession. Like I get pretty obsessed with composition. Here, you know, you look for a space, negative space, to put the head. If I would have broken that line, I couldn't use that photo. If I would have broken that line, I couldn't use that photo. So I'm always looking for good negative space. That's step one when I go to a portrait. Well, either light or that. So I'm looking for good light, I'm looking for negative space to put the person's head. If there's a light pole coming out of the head, if there's part of that E coming out of the person's head, I can't use it. So I need a good, clean space. So, I mean, I think most people understand on a really gut level this concept. So, like, if I were to draw a stick figure house, big tree here. Oh, this would be green. All right, so there's a big tree. So, if you were to draw a picture of a person in this house or somewhere in this scene, you'd probably pick a space where you're not going to put the person like right there. Because then it's just, you know, they just kind of like blend in with the door, blend in with the walkway. So, you know, you want to find some negative space, you know, here, or if they're right up against the building, you know, it could have them right here. And that's a 4-year-old understands that concept. I think we all do in this context. But as soon as you have a camera and you're walking around trying to frame a person, everyone kind of forgets it. So use your 4-year-old brain and just think about where in this scene does the person fit. And look for that negative space. Look for something where the elements of the picture are kind of framing the person in. And I'll have some other examples. And even this is where the two kind of combine. So if you learn how to look through a camera as if you were looking, you know, seeing the picture, or even look through your eyes as if you were looking through a camera, you'll understand that, you know, to my eyes, maybe this difference between this light and this dark wasn't so extreme, but if you know how the camera works, then you know that it's going to be that. And so I use that shadow as my compositional, my framing element. So that's that combination of light and composition coming together. It doesn't have to be just like these lines, you know, that's part of your composition. I'm framing within this stuff, but I'm also using the light as my compositional you know, here it's just kind of framing between these lines. and picking the location that is going to have nice window light. This is right by the window and by the door of the cafe in Asheville. And directing him to look where I want so that the light's going to fall off right where I want it to. And then positioning him in the scene where it fits. So that's the elements coming all together. This was for Wall Street Journal recently. This guy, Ron Rash. It's another example. See the shadow, how it kind of made the shape above his head? Like a little halo kind of thing? That is using light and composition to frame and direct the eye of the viewer. So all these tools are basically directing your eye. When you look at this picture, your eye is going to go straight to here. I'm making your eye go straight to there. Those are deliberate choices that I made to say you're going to look right there. I'm kind of trying to hammer some of these same points. So these are a lot of these photos make the same point, but I want to make it very clear because if you learn just a couple of things today, I really want you to learn to look at light, how it comes in, how to direct the person to look where you want them to where they get the right light, because the light's coming in here, so you know you want it to kind of hit both their eyes. And then, obviously, again, I'm composing within this space, but then the more, you know, the next level of that is also this tree in the background, framing just inside the head. Yeah, that's the kind of like, that's the easy one, and then that's the more like you're really looking for framing the person within the scene. So there's two types of portraits. There's an environmental portrait, and then there's just your standard portrait. An environmental portrait gives a sense of the whole scene, and the parts of the scene tell a story of who this person is and why we care about them, etc. A standard portrait is kind of more just about aesthetics and driving the eye to the person's face, and good light, good composition, good colors, things like that. So environmental portraits are much more difficult because you have to find order in a more complex scene. And a lot of times that means just framing it right and then just waiting for a moment. You know? So here I had the shot kind of framed up right. You know, I have him framing it on the left and skateboarders in the background. And then I just waited for the moment with her. She kind of like snapped up at me and that was the shot. So this is the opposite. This is your kind of standard portrait of taking a scene that might be, you know, all who knows what, and then simplifying it into this very basic clean scene. This is their skate park. So, you know, I could have shot that showing a whole scene like I did the last one. You know, this is also a skate scene. I could have shot it more like that, but I kind of wanted to just focus it on his face. So I used a ramp as my backdrop and made it as simple and clean as possible. Which there's not a one or the other that's better. It's kind of, you choose which one you're going to do and you go as far as you can with it. A complex scene, you're responsible for all these different elements coming together, and in a simple standard portrait, you're looking for minimizing the clutter and just getting that nice, clean shot, focusing on light, focusing on a more minimalistic approach. Let's see what's next here. And that's simplifying. This was for a commercial shoot, so I actually like, took some of the stuff off the walls, made it down bare bones, using the reflection as just a really simple way of making it graphic. See how his head's slightly angled this way, but still looking at me? That was a way of, I wanted the eye contact, but I still wanted the light to come across for that eye. So you can, you know, if the light's not falling quite right, remember, you're in control, and you get to tell that person, bring your face a little bit this way, still eyes to me, and then you can really report. I'll get to that in a minute. How much is on time? We can wrap it up fairly quick. Just one more thing on composition. So when you're doing a more complex composition, like the woman with the skateboarders around her, you need to think of composition as more than just where is your primary subject in the frame. You're thinking about each object or person in the picture as subjects. So you're responsible for all of them and where they are in the scene. So you have to kind of
position yourself to organize what's in the frame, and like you would a drawing, and be very deliberate about what's in and out of the picture. So you look at each edge of the picture and say, you know, if there's something kind of poking in a little bit, it's like, okay, we don't want that in, so we cut it out. If there's almost all of something, then maybe you widen out a little bit and you get that edge. So you kind of look at each border and try to make each part of the frame very decisive. And this is in, this is out. You know, it's all decisions that you make. Okay, so the last thing is about working with the subject. And this is actually, according to my notes, the last thing I was gonna talk about, but I'll talk about it now. I have a trick that I do on most shoots where I never officially start or end a shoot. I kind of ease into it and ease out of it, because people tend to kind of tense up when it's like, okay, now this is it. Now this is the photo shoot. So they're like, okay. But what I tend to do is say, you know, I need to take some test shots. I'm gonna just kind of get my light figured out, get my exposure figured out. So they're just kind of sitting, you know, they're not paying much attention to what you're doing. And that's when you can catch some like nice moments. This is on a cruise ship. And of course I was just drawn to the zebra pattern continuing on the bench through her dress. So I asked if I could take a picture, and she's like, yeah, well, I just gotta put on some makeup first. And so I got the shot while she's putting on the makeup, and that's the one that I actually really like, as opposed to the one afterwards where she's posing for the picture. The next one is an example of the opposite. This is a friend of mine, we were skateboarding in Atlanta. He had just hit his face on a wall trying a trick, and so I asked him to do a portrait. So I set him down on these stairs, framed him where I wanted in between the building, and then I was like, okay, got it, you know. And then as he started to get up after I said we were done, I still had my camera ready, and that's when he kind of winced in pain as he was getting up, and I, you know, that's much better than the just deadpan looking at the camera. So stay ready, you know. If you say you're done or you say, you know, we haven't started yet, you're still ready with the camera and snapping away. One of the most important things I've learned is that through photography, I'd say it's the most important thing I've learned in photography, is that through journalism and through this amazing process of like getting to spend time with different people every day, you learn that you can really connect with anybody. No matter who it is, no matter how much you think you're different from them, if you make an effort, you can find something in common with that person and find some way to relate to them or connect to them. I won't get into my own political affiliations or anything, but this was a shoot for Al Jazeera recently where it was a rebel flag or Confederate flag rally in Tennessee. And this guy was the main subject of the story, Matthew Heimbach. He's like a leader in the separatist white nationalist movement. His goal is to kind of separate the country into separate countries with like all the black people living in one place, all the white people living in one place, all the Jewish people living in one place. So he's like trying to make this happen. You know, that's far from my vision of the world.
Wonderful.
But, you know, I spent the whole day with him. He was a nice enough person that I was able to have friendly conversation with him. He was, you know, we were able to kind of like talk about his plans and in like a way where I could kind of poke fun at it and make light of it, but we're not yelling at each other, we're not, you know, arguing. And so we were able to have a pleasant enough time, and I was, you know, able to get some pictures that weren't aggressively attacking him. And I kind of leave it up to the viewer to decide what they think of him, rather than me saying, this is a horrible person, and I, you know, I can do things with light and with, you know, composition and things that kind of tell you what to think, and this is an attempt to not do that too much. That's another one from the rally. This is a little bit more of like me making them look not so good. But position someone where they're going to be comfortable. This is Radio. If you've ever seen the movie Radio with Cuba Gooding Jr., this is like the real guy. He lives in South Carolina, and he, you know, if you know the story, he's been involved in the school T.L. Hanna his whole life, and he's been like a junior in high school since he was a teenager, and he's now in his 60s. So, you know, I just sat him down on his bed and told him to look through his yearbook, because he has yearbooks for, you know, like years and years and years. There's so many yearbooks, and he's in every single one of them. He's really proud of that. So I just had him kind of sit there and look through. So this is an environmental portrait where you get a sense of, this is his room. You see that he's proud of these posters and stuff. He's proud of his yearbooks, but you're still getting this kind of, you know, getting to see him a little bit. This is about emotionally prepping someone for whatever you need to get out of them to communicate what you want to communicate. If I tried to get into this story, it would take another 30 minutes. But anyway, we had to go through a process, about an hour-long process, to get him to that point where he was ready to just kind of break down emotionally, which was what both of us wanted for this picture. They wanted to get it just completely break down the barriers and let go. But that involved, I told him to bring old pictures and things that brought up memories from this period, this, you know, sexual abuse history and stuff like that. So it took a while to prime him for that experience. It's a good idea sometimes to ask a person how they want to be represented. This is in Cherokee, and I met this person just kind of out on the street, and we started talking. I said, I'd like to take your portrait, and I'm very sensitive about how I represent Cherokee people or Native American people in general, because there's this kind of just long history of, you know, unbalance. So I kind of wanted to give some of that balance back and say, like, you tell me how you want to be photographed. I'm not going to depict you the way I choose. I'm going to depict you how you want. So he said, you know, shoot me in my element. This is, the river is my element. So we went in the river and got this picture. And I thought, you know, maybe I wouldn't have come up with something that good. I left it up to him to come up with it, and that was worked out. This is just kind of something I threw in there to remind you to think outside of the box. This was a band shoot that I did, and this publication is called The Fader that I was shooting for. Really cool music publication. All their stuff is really different, and it's always really unique, and it's a fun challenge to shoot for them, because I know they want something different, and I have to really push myself. And so for this one, I had one of their friends drive by their house over and over again, and I was in the car with the camera, just clicking as I went by with kind of a slower shutter speed, so that's what creates this movement. And I just did it over and over again until I got the shot I wanted. But that's an example of, you know, come up with something different. You know, it's all, so much of photography has been done.
How many times did you have to shoot that before you, because there's that really cool effect where it looks like they're almost totally still and everything around them is moving. Like,
yeah, we passed by probably 10 times. And each time I shot, you know, I'm shooting on like motor drive, so each one's maybe 20 pictures as I go, you know, so. That might be the last one, I'm not sure. This is another example of thinking outside the box. This is in moonlight outside at night. It was the middle of the night. So if you have a camera that can handle low light like that and a tripod, you can get a very different look than you could any other way.
How open, or would you shoot that? Slow.
Yeah. That's probably a fifth of a second, I would guess. ISO is probably around 8,000, which you have to have a good camera to shoot 8,000 ISO and not have it look totally noisy.
Yeah.
And aperture is like 1.4 probably. So it's just basically maxing out what the camera is capable of. That picture was not very possible 5 years ago, but the technology is kind of advanced where you can shoot these really high ISOs and it still looks good. Let me see real quick if there's anything. Kind of going back to interacting with the subjects. It's very important to realize that energy is contagious. So a lot of people are very nervous about photographing other people, especially, you know, getting started with it. But that nervous energy is going to transfer to that person. They're going to feel nervous if you're nervous. And if you want them to be calm, you need to really kind of slow down, take deep breaths, and be calm. Because whatever energy you bring into the the shoot is kind of what they're going to give you back. And it's also the same with, like, you know, you want to stay conversational. Even as you're shooting, you can kind of bring the camera down and ask some questions or something like that, just to kind of get a conversation going, loosen them up. But what questions you ask are going to drive the mood. So if you need, you know, if it's a sad picture, then you need to ask about whatever it is that is the hard time that they're going through. Or if it's, you just kind of want to lighten the mood and you want a nice light picture, then just ask them about whatever they're into, and just kind of try to give back whatever energy you're trying to get from them. And I think that's pretty much covers the basics. Yep. Okay.
Questions?
Yeah.
Okay. For that first photo, was there any artificial light?
No.
Okay.
Most of these, almost all of those were totally natural light. The one of the guy in the orange car was lit. That was like pretty hard light. And the one of the author sitting on his porch,
yeah.
That was a little additional light, subtle additional light, but it was some. Other than that, I think they were all natural light.
What additional?
I have a car full of stuff. Five different. I use Alien B lighting, which are just, you know, flash heads, and you can put any kind of modifier on those. Soft boxes, beauty dishes, all these different things. I use the one that I use the most, and for both of those pictures was a beauty dish. A beauty dish is like. Say this, the light shoots through here and then bounces off of a metal plate here back into this. Say it's more, a little bit more curved out, and then it just kind of wraps around. So it creates a nice sharp but soft light. It's a nice in between, because hard light can be really sharp but kind of abrasive, and the beauty dish is really sharp but not abrasive. It's like nice, wraps around nicely. Yeah.
What are you going to tell us what you're going to do?
Okay, so we're going to go outside and kind of put some of this stuff to practice. We're going to figure out a good spot for a shoot in bad conditions.
So you can leave your stuff and come back? Okay.
And we're going to, we'll work together to figure out what a good spot is, find a good location, and take a few shots. This right now. These like light spots are gonna be, to the camera, it's very different from your eyes. This is gonna be way too bright right here, or way too dark where I don't have the light spots. So don't use a tree as shade. Tree is no good. Let's take a walk over this way, and we'll start to look for some spots that might be shaded out and have some nice compositional elements. I'm immediately drawn to this building. So does anyone have any idea why this building would be of interest?
The leading lines, and then also there's a lot of like dead space to frame somebody like composition wise.
Exactly. So I don't know if everyone heard that. She said there's good leading lines, so there's good, this is very geometric kind of a building. There's lots of good lines to work with, and there's some shade, and there's also nice big chunks of really just solid gray to work with, or I can frame people. During a different time of day when we could shoot up here, this would be even better, because I really like the lines going on right here, but the sunlight is kind of prohibitive with that. So let's look around where we can find some shade and all the other things we want. So I'm starting to see some things I like here. You see how when I'm looking at this wall here, it's kind of broken up into sections. There's like, it's much lighter over there, and then it's the darkest in the middle there, and then a little bit lighter here. I can see how I could compose someone's head in that darker space and have those two lines be the framing. And I think it's worth giving a try. I'm also seeing some decent options looking this way. All these lines converging are kind of nice. They could put the person's head kind of right in the middle and let all the lines come forward. But let's start with this. I'm gonna get my camera. Tell me your name one more time.
Hongsha.
Hongsha?
Yeah.
Did I say it right?
Yes.
Hongsha?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's figure out where to position her. We have a nice, this whole section is all in the shade, so that's good. We have all this to work with. So come over around about here.
I'm sorry, I forgot to dress. Just the jeans, it's okay.
Oh yeah, it's fine. Yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna start to look at her and see where the light's coming from. So it's more subtle right now. The light, the direction of the light is more subtle, but you can start to see, sorry, this is not the way I normally do a shoot, but it's coming more from this side because this is the open space. So we want to kind of position her to where she's a little bit more open to this nice space right here. So right where, the way she is, perfect. Okay, so next thing I'm realizing is I have her too far back because perspective is everything. If I have her closer to me, so start walking closer to me, then I can have her head kind of fit right in between these lines. Just right, keep coming. We're gonna keep coming a good 10 feet, 15 feet. All right, give me a little room here. All right, right about there. So what just changed is now, when I'm looking at her, I see these two lines just on either side of her shoulders. Back there, they were way on other sides of her. So now it's more of a framing element because, you know, it's just right on either side of her, so it gives us a nice framing of her. So if everyone can kind of see where I'm looking from, look at her, we're seeing that the light's coming in from here. See how this cheek is darker and this cheek is lighter?
Wouldn't the head have to shift so the eye wouldn't be dark on the left, right side?
Right now, it's still good because it's coming in from a pretty big area over here. So it's not really looking too dark. Bring your eyes, look this way. Keep coming. Keep turning your head this way. Here, we're starting to lose the light on this side of her face. But if I keep it back over here, then that to me is a nice light. It's hitting most of her face and then starting to fall off on the far side. And we're actually also getting a little kickback light off of this wall. The light is actually bouncing off of here and then hitting this side of her cheek. So if you see this little highlight right here, you guys all see that? That's like the effect of studio lighting. That's what you'd kind of do, is you'd have a light right here a lot of the time to give that little rim light, that little separation. But a lot of times you just get it naturally. So I'm using an 85 millimeter lens right now. It's not a zoom lens. Sorry, I'm formatting my cards real quick. Okay. 85 millimeter lens is a longer lens, which means it compresses the scene. If I use the wide lens, I'd be seeing everything around, but I don't want to do that in this shot. I want to keep it really simple. All I'm going to see is gray. From the sidewalk, from the walls, everything is kind of monochrome, and then the color on her shirt is going to really pop because it's going to be the only color in the whole picture. So just basically, you're going to be positioned the way you are, however you feel most comfortable. You know, your hands can be like this, or hands like that, or just kind of, you can even shift around a little bit. This is something I tell people a lot, is to kind of just move around a little bit. Doesn't even matter what you're doing, just shift, that way you don't get too stiff. So just, you know, even as simple as just shifting your weight back and forth a little bit, just to stay loose. And then you're just going to look at the camera. You don't have to smile necessarily. Just give a kind of a genuine look toward the camera. And I'm going to just do some test shots and get my lighting figured out, which is true. I really do need to do that. But as you guys know, I'm also going to continue shooting. Yeah, this is extra tricky because you're not only being in a photo shoot, you're having a whole class looking at you. But so you're a grad student, which means what? It means you've already graduated and then you're coming back to learn more? What does it mean to be a grad student?
Yeah, I'm a grad student.
So what are you learning about?
Already
talked
about education.
The what?
Already talked
about
education.
Okay, what made you interested in that? Why are you interested in early childhood education?
I like children.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
And also, I have all of my girls' background is about education.
Oh, okay. Did you go to school somewhere else first?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, second year. It's my second year.
Second year here?
Yeah.
Did you go somewhere else before here?
No.
No? Yeah, cool. What kind of job do you hope to get after you graduate?
I'm not sure. Maybe we'll go back to China. I'm from China.
Oh, okay. So do you have like a visa for a certain amount of time and then you go back?
Maybe.
Okay. Yeah. What?
Should they be shooting?
Yeah, you guys can, if you want to just kind of get a sense for how to see the scene, you guys can take out your cameras and shoot some. Would it help if I show like the shot that I'm doing? Okay, so anyone who wants to see kind of the way that I'm composing this shot, you can. Sorry, kind of hard to see in the bright light, but just kind of framing her in between there. The light's nice, and it's a nice simple picture because, you know, you're not getting a whole lot of distractions.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. So yeah, I guess at this point we can let everyone else take some lead. You can try some different angles if you guys want. There's really lots of options down here. Does anyone else want to kind of take the driver's seat? Remember your framing, and you can tell her to move if you want. And you can find different frames. Like right now, if I'm kind of up high, I have a nice, once there's no one in the background, I'll have a nice composition of just putting her head within under the stairs, within that space behind her. I have to get on my tiptoes though to make it work. But if you guys want to see what that composition looks like, that's, you know, I don't want to break that line of right above her head. So if I'm up on my tiptoes, I was able to, you know, frame her within this space right here. And you got, you know, nice other lines. And the light's still good, it's coming in from this side.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Why your background is blurry, but the people is very clear?
Yeah, that's the lens.
The lens?
Yeah. Yeah, you have. There's the handout that I gave you with the technical information, the part that I didn't talk about, explains it. It explains how to get that effect. You can, to some degree, get it with any other lens with settings. You can set the settings right and it'll do that.
What lens can make like this?
It's
a long.
The longer the lens, the more it does that. So this is 85, so it's kind of on the longer side. This one goes to 55, this is your longest, so you can't do it quite as much, but you can do it a little bit.
In your pack, you have a longer lens, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We have like a 75 to 300 or something like that.
So that'll help. Should we go back?
Sure. Does anyone else want to try anything else here?
Done?
I think so, unless someone else wants to try something.
What's your name?
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate
it. So
just real quick, just a little bit about what we just did and what we can learn from it. Really, you need to plan more time for a shoot than what we just had, for sure. It takes a while to start to get someone comfortable. You know, you need to just kind of continue talking to them, and then you'll start to see, after a while, people will start to relax. But it doesn't happen that quickly. So, I mean, some people are different, you know, some people relax very quickly. But generally, give yourself plenty of time. Don't rush in and rush out to a shoot. Really take your time, And to really, like, to me, to honor that person, you need to give them your time and your full attention for a decent block of time. I always get as much time as I possibly can with people. I tell them to block off at least an hour so I can really try to connect and get a nice picture. So,
yeah, I worked with what I had on this picture. I didn't pick a good camera yet, but like, I'm
okay.
Just trying to get a candid shot of him.
Okay, so as the candid shot, it's okay. As a portrait, there's lots of things that could be done better. So if the assignment is to get a portrait, then you need to remember that you are in control. You can tell this person to do whatever you want. So it's good to have them, if you want an environmental portrait, it's good to have them doing something, but again, you have some control. The way the person is kind of faced away from you, you could have just had them pivot around to where they're more faced toward you. And then, you know, this is a light source. This is a decent light source. I actually really like, you know, computer screen lighting because it just creates a different color. That blue light can be kind of interesting. So, you know, you could have had them angled more toward you, and then you can take some candid shots and then just say, hey, whatever his name is, and have him kind of look up at the camera and then, you know, snap a shot of them looking at the camera so it's more of a portrait. But it's still a very natural portrait. You know, it's nice to get someone in a very natural setting doing whatever they're doing and then just kind of get their attention.
Yeah, I kind of love him like facing more towards me.
Yeah.
I kind of like it, I don't know. Like, but I didn't notice that little door there right there on the side. If I would have noticed that,
I
wouldn't have took that picture because it's asymmetrical.
And that's like a little step to the left that you could do. And in this situation, you didn't want to take that step to the left because you didn't want to lose any more of his face.
Yeah.
But if you had directed him to where you weren't going to lose part of his face, then you could have taken that step to the left and gotten rid of that little thing there. I better go through him. Oh, that's interesting. So who shot this one?
That's me. This is kind of... So my focus on my camera's broken, one. So it took me forever to get this in focus. Two, we're underneath stairs. Mm-hmm. Three, there's like a complete forest behind there. So I was...
That's okay, because you did good. You.
Yeah, four, her face, five. Oh, God.
No, it's okay, but... Yeah, just... There's a portrait. That's the thing about portrait photography. There's in any other situation, there's a million excuses that the conditions weren't right.
Yeah.
In a portrait, there's always a good portrait to be made. It's just a matter of finding it. Mm-hmm. And since I wasn't in the scene, so I don't know what may have made it a little bit better. But it's not bad. It's nice and simple. I like that there's not a lot of distracting elements there. The light is okay. But it's just these hot spots.
Yeah.
So I don't know if there was room to go a little bit farther in or...
There wasn't. And the thing is like she was in like spandex shorts and there were like a bunch of spiders and everything. So yeah. And I thought this assignment was due today. So that was another thing. And...
Yeah.
I told Miss Biscotti to like pick one, and that's what she picked.
Yeah.
Well, let's say what I do like is the angling of her face with the light coming in this way. Does it creates a nice fall off right there?
Yeah, I liked the lighting on her face right here.
Yeah.
I liked the shadow.
Yeah.
But if I had gotten into Photoshop a little bit, I would have fixed on her chin and her neck and her hair because it's way too. Saturated there.
Yeah, and
she
I mean,
brush your hair. Obviously,
so would you do that in Photoshop, or would you just try to find the best
one? I don't do it in Photoshop. No, I would. Well, I mean, you can do little subtle stuff in Photoshop.
Yeah, like a little bit of subtlety because it's just like you said, it's too.
But the main thing is just positioning. So even as simple as like coming around a little bit, maybe would have made the highlights fall, you know, on the side of her face mm-hmm. instead of on her chin. You know, if you were moved over here and brought her eyes around with you a little bit, it's hard to say without being in the scene, but it's always possible. Mm-hmm. There's always a good portrait to be made in any scene. Mm-hmm. There's some scenes you walk in and it's just like, perfect. Other scenes, there's like, you kind of panic for a second. You're like, oh crap, this is gonna be hard. But there's always a way. There's, for a portrait, you are in control, you can drive, just slow down. And maybe if you would have taken 5 minutes to walk around, you may have found another space that would have been even better. But I kind of like, you know, the shadow here is nice. It kind of helps frame it in a little bit. I don't mind the texture of brick wall, but it's not my favorite. You know, a little bit more distance would have made the background a little bit softer, but again, you're under stairs, so as soon as you come out, then you're gonna get a lot more direct light. But it's a good composition. I like the framing, and the light is almost there, so it's not, it's really not a bad shot at all. And who's this?
She asked me to show it. When did
you come back? I took that in 2010. Actually, that was during Taipusam, when I lived in Malaysia.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was with a Canon, my vehicle lens, my telescope lens. I forgot what it was. But yeah.
Cool. It does a good job of really isolating.
Yeah.
See, that's the thing with a telephoto lens, is longer lenses. It's really easy to remove the clutter. This is probably like a parade with a whole bunch of people around.
Oh, yeah.
But all you're really seeing is, you know, you're drawn really into that, the person's face. So, yeah. And also, there's harsh light. It's bad time of day for lighting. But none of that bad light is getting on the face, which is good. So sometimes you have to shoot in not great light. But if you can keep the person's face evenly lit, turn them away from the light, then at least, you know, you got even light here. And I don't mind a highlight on the neck or something.
So would you say that this, because we got two lenses in our with our cameras, mm-hmm. or at least the ones we got cameras, would you say that like a 75 to 300 would be better to do portraits with than the 18 to 55?
It depends on whether you're doing like the standard clean portrait or the environmental portrait. The wider lens is great for the environmental portrait where you're trying to get a sense of the space and context. Environmental portrait's all about context, the person in a space that helps tell the story. Wider lens is great for that. Longer lens is good for just aesthetics, like just nice, clean, pretty pictures like that.
Garrett's being surprised by me picking one of his pictures. I'm not saying, I just picked like Palest when editing this one. I thought there was an interaction between the young player and the old character.
It is a good shot. It's not exactly a portrait, but the setting would be great for a portrait. The light's kind of coming in soft right here. If you had framed, say this was a portrait, this is you?
Yes.
Okay. Say if you had set up for a portrait, meaning a more direct interaction between you and the subject rather than the subject and someone else, if you had the person right there where they are and framed him between this line and this line, that gives you some nice framing. The light's nice. Even kind of using this to kind of break up the frame a little bit, it's nice. It gives you a nice little frame right here. So that has the potential to be a great portrait. And as a moment, it's a good moment too. I would have liked to back off a little bit more because I don't like to cut things off at awkward places. So I'd like to have the rest of his knee. Even like this, you know, either cut that out or keep it in. What would help me make that decision would be if his foot is there, I can't cut that out and keep his foot. So I would step back, get his knee, get this person's head. And that's pretty much it. There's a great picture right there. It's just a matter of slight movements, slight adjustments, and maybe waiting, you know. I shoot fast in a situation like this where I'm shooting moments. So maybe a fraction of a second later, he'd gone a little bit farther, and then you get this person framed in between them. Maybe, maybe not. Maybe by that time, the moment's already gone, the hands aren't touching, but maybe it's there. So when I see it about to happen, the moment about to happen, it's just, you know, as fast as I can, just shoot. Because, you know, the difference between a half a second can be, well, even way less than a half a second can be dramatic. Is this? I like the composition, except that it could, I would have chosen a spot with a little bit more of a clean place to put the person's head. So this isn't bad. It's not like a fence. I'm not squirming, but you know, this coming out of the side of the head is not great. This person's arm going into the shoulder is not great. That looks like a very busy scene, but if you want to show this person in this context, that's just your challenge, is trying to find somewhere in this busy, hectic scene with all this distracting stuff, finding somewhere where you can find some clean negative space and some nice leading lines or something for the composition. But it's, as those things go, you know, it's not a huge faux pas. You didn't, here again, like this hook coming out right here, even something little like that, if you had gone up on your tiptoes or a little bit higher, you could have maybe cleared that. Just try to find the place where the person fits in the composition. The light is not bad. We don't have shadows in the eyes or anything, so that's good. It's a little bit warm, a little bit warmer than I would like, although the colors are weird on this computer too.
Yeah, they're better over here.
Yeah, they're better on that.
That looks much better to me. So yeah, that's, I would just say, you know, is this in a kitchen? Walk-in cooler is gonna be a nice solid compositional space to put someone. Just look around for the right space. Who's this? I wouldn't consider this a portrait. It's a nice found moment, but in a portrait, you know, you would be getting really having some control over the scene. And so, did you have a particular person here as a subject, or was it just?
More the girl with the guitar.
Okay, that is where my eye is led. So that's good. So if I'm looking at this picture, the first thing I'm going to look at is the girl with the guitar, and that's important that you lead the eye where you want. So her frame, and you know, there's stuff going on around her, but it's framed to be she is the main point of interest. And she is, you know, it's obviously a sunny, bright day, but she's in the shade, so that's good. We don't have any of this harsh light on her. But it doesn't work as a portrait because, you know, you're not singling her out. And as a portrait, I would say just get everyone else out and go in a little tighter and just kind of find a frame in here that really brings the attention in even more. Who's this? Okay. So is this surveying or what's the person doing?
It's an engineer, constructor, student.
Yeah. So it's a good shot of someone doing something, but as again, kind of the same issue. I'm seeing that I think maybe there's a little bit of a fear of stopping the person and taking control of the scene. You know, you kind of let a moment happen, which is, you know, that's good to do, but as a portrait, you would want to kind of position the person specifically for a portrait rather than just catching a moment of them doing whatever they're doing. So if you're assigned to go get a portrait, you know, you're going to tell that person, I need 20 minutes of your time to not be doing that, and find a position that works well with, you know, all these guidelines. Good light and good, nice, simple. See, there's a lot going on back here. These poles and these cars, you know, it's a little bit too much clutter. Like what we just did down there, that was just very simple. You know, it's all just kind of the same color and just very clean. That brings your eye right into the viewer. Here, my eye's kind of jumping all over the place. But otherwise, you know, it's a good composition, and it's a good moment. You captured what they're doing, but you know, just take control and tell them what you need them to do and move them if you need to. Is that the end? Is that everyone?
You know, I had the one that came up first about the guy that was getting the book off the shelf, but
Oh, was that back somewhere? I didn't see that one.
I didn't see it in that, but when she opened something up, I saw it.
Let's see if she can help us find them. Or if, I don't know if everyone needs to go, but... Okay. Yeah, sure. I don't think they were all on there for some reason.
The one where the guy was getting the book was mine. That came out.
Should have been the first.
Yeah, this is a great example of just finding those leading lines, brings the attention right in. I don't even, you know, it's okay that it breaks this line to me. I don't mind that. It's especially as it kind of gets farther away, it becomes just pattern. And as a portrait, I would, you know, did you get some, like, looking at the camera too?
Yeah, I got one of the stepping stools and got, because he was tall, like, above him reaching for a book. Mm-hmm. But I picked this one, but after the lesson today, I know what you're talking about, like, more of his face straight on.
Yeah, I think, I mean, see, here's the kind of ethical dilemma with portraits is you can't really shoot a portrait that looks like a moment. Here, you know, sometimes a moment will happen while you're shooting a portrait, and that's kind of a different thing, but, like, having the person looking at the book, that's kind of like directing to do something. Mm-hmm. That's not necessarily looking like a portrait. So that's kind of a line that, as a journalist, I try not to, I don't cross. But if you have eye contact, then it's clear that it's a portrait, and it's a little bit more, you can blur those lines a little bit more. But you don't want to create a moment, like the reaching for the book,
yeah.
That's creating a moment. Yeah, you can't do that.
Moments of the journalist, you
could right.
Caught them, and then the portraits.
Yeah.
Yeah, so if it's going to be a portrait, it needs to be clearly a portrait.
Well, I hope my sheet is clear. I think I have a little bit of both on there. I'm asking for 15 pictures. And that, you'll
get all. Yeah, I'll get more feedback on those once I get them. All right, thanks, guys.
Thanks for speaking up.